David Gasparotto, que nos acompaña hoy. Es graduado en Historia del Arte y Arqueología Clásica por la Universidad de Pisa y doctorado en la Escuela Normale Superiore. Es, desde 2014, conservador de pintura en el Museo Paul Getty. Antes de ostentar este cargo, desarrolló una amplia carrera investigadora en instituciones como la Fundación Piero della Francesca, de la que fue director durante 3 años, la Galería Nacional de Parma o la Galería Estense de Módena, en la que fue conservador jefe del Departamento de Escultura y Artes Decorativas. Su línea de investigación gira en torno al arte italiano del Renacimiento, especialmente en la escultura, la orfebrería, clíptica y medallística del Cinquecento, la presencia de la tradición clásica en la cultura moderna y su recuperación en el Ottocento italiano. Sus estudios se reflejan en numerosas publicaciones y conferencias y ha participado en numerosas exposiciones en torno a estos temas. Muchas gracias.
I am really sorry that I'm not going to speak in Spanish, although it may seem strange since I am Italian, but but that's now the reality of my life. And I would like to thank you very much, Melania Soler, for the invitation to come and to speak here today. I'm really pleased to be here. I love Madrid, and so it's a great opportunity to spend here some days. And I would love also to thank you very much, Maria Boluda, for the excellent organization, warm hospitality, and for really organizing everything about my trip. I interpreted well the wishes of the organizers in like presenting a quite broad talk, a sort of a framework for the discussions that we are going to have over the course of the day. So with that, I will start. One of the most celebrated portraits of the Italian Renaissance, the so-called Montefeltro diptych by Piero della Francesca, features the Duke of Urbino, Federico del Montefeltro, and his wife, Battista Sforza. The two figures are shown in profile, facing each other. They inhabit the same space, suggested by the fall of light and the continuity of the rolling landscape in the background, representing the area of the Marche region over which they ruled. The chromatic contrast between the bronze skin tones used for Federico and the pale tones of Battista Sforza is striking. Her pallor respects the aesthetic conventions which were fashionable during the Renaissance, although it has been suggested that it could also allude to her untimely death in 1472. There is a big discussion about the chronology of these portraits, if they were done while Battista was living or she was already dead. But I'm not going to go into this. The allegorical scenes painted on the back of the portraits complement the portraits, and their meaning is enhanced by the inscriptions on the simulated architectural edge below them. The iconography is based on a complex tradition dating back to the Roman Triumph, which was further enriched by a series of allegorical poems by the 14th century Italian poet Francesco Petrarca. The Roman Triumphs celebrated military victories, but Petrarch's triumphs were allegories of love, chastity, death, fame, time, and eternity. Federico's triumphal chariot is drawn by a team of white horses, as was traditional for victorious commanders in antiquity. He is accompanied by allegorical figures of the four cardinal virtues, prudence, justice, fortitude, and temperance, the attributes of a good ruler. Battista's triumphal car is instead drawn by unicorns, symbolic of chastity, governed by a winged cupid, symbolic of love, and carries the three theological virtues, faith, hope, and charity. She's accompanied by those virtues which were considered necessary requirements of a Renaissance noble woman, and the inscription points to her role as a loyal and capable consort of a famous leader and to her reputation of modesty. I translate a portion of the inscription, "She that kept her modesty in favorable circumstances flies on the mouth of all men, adorned with the praise of her great husband's exploits." Both inscriptions stress the criteria of moderation and decency, modus and decentia. Battista remains modest in happiness. Federico wields power in a proper way, decenter. These extraordinary portraits contain all the essential ingredients that are also features of the Renaissance medal: the combination of word and image, and a double-sided composition which includes an individual portrait and a figuration that usually elucidates character, moral values, and aspirations of the sitter. In this example, by the Florentine sculptor Bertoldo Di Giovanni, the Venetian noblewoman Letizia Sanudo is celebrated on the reverse with a triumph of chastity that has a lot in common with the analogous scene on Piero's panel. Two rearing unicorns pull a chariot led by a young boy and pushed by a winged putto. The woman seated on the chariot might be Letizia herself, like Battista in the painting by Piero. The figure standing in front of her is a winged, blindfolded Cupid holding a bow. The third woman restraining the unicorns, I hope it's visible, might be the personification of chastity. Above them, another female figure descends, bringing a leafy branch to the seated woman. Below, two putti are holding a tablet with the inscription Decus MV, the glory of the women of Venice, where MV probably stands for Matronarum Venetarum. Below the tablet is the coat of arms of the Sanudo family. Chastity, as we will see, was considered a virtue of paramount importance for Renaissance women. In his Libri della Famiglia, Leon Battista Alberti declared that l'onestà in ciascuna sempre più valse che ogni bellezza. Chastity has always been worth more to anyone than beauty. It is impossible to consider the vocabulary of the Renaissance medal without considering its classical antecedents. The formula of the portrait in profile has a strong association with the cult of classical antiquity that was so pervasive in Italian humanistic circles of the 15th century. A contemporary observer would have been aware that classical authors, such as Pliny the Elder in his Naturalis Historia, or Quintiliano in his Institutio Oratoria, associated the birth of individual portraiture in ancient Greece with modeling in clay a profile portrait. Humanists were also aware of the fact that it was through antique coins that it was possible to recognize the appearance of the most illustrious individuals from Greek and Roman history. The poet Petrarch, already in the 14th century, compared the features of emperors and empresses on ancient coins with the literary descriptions offered by ancient authors. Here I show an early 14th century manuscript by a Veronese writer which talks about lives of ancient emperors and draws on the margin of the sheet little drawings with ancient coins, ancient Roman coins. In his book on famous women, Giovanni Boccaccio was able to talk about the celebrated beauty of the Empress Faustina the Younger, the wife of Marcus Aurelius, looking at Roman coins where she was portrayed. And I quote from Boccaccio: "Faustina possessed such exquisite grace as to make it credible that something divine had been infused into her mortal body. To prevent her beauty from being consumed by old age or death, it was decreed that her portrait as a young girl and then as a mature woman should be engraved on gold, silver, and copper coins. and thus it still survives today. Even through the expression of the mouth, the movement of the eyes, the vivid complexion, and the cheerfulness of her countenance are missing from such likenesses, the features nonetheless attest to extraordinary beauty. It is probable that Boccaccio was conflating both ancient Faustinas, the elder, the wife of Antoninus Pius, and the younger, the wife of Marcus Aurelius, one, especially the elder, especially celebrated for her virtue, and the other, the younger, for her beauty, but a little bit less for her reputation, by ancient writers, like the much-read Scriptores Historia Augustae. Anyway, over the course of the 400, Faustina the Elder became a role model for wife and mother. Her posthumous strikings, where her portrait is surrounded by a legend starting Diva, as you can see here in the coin of Faustina the Elder, were very influential on Renaissance medal of women. Here I show three examples of, you know, Renaissance noble women: Antonia del Balzo, Giulia Staglia, and the mysterious Giulia, probably also from Mantua, where the inscription starts with Diva, so the same type of the coins with Faustina. The reverses of ancient coins of both Faustinas, with various personifications, such as Pudicitia or Concordia, or a depiction of Venus, meaning beauty, or depiction of Eternitas, so values alluding to the survival, posthumous survival, celebrated moral values that were considered particularly desirable and appropriate to the 15th century female. In this modern recreation of a medal of the Empress Faustina the Elder by the Florentine sculptor and architect Filarete, the portrait on the obverse is based on depiction of the Empress in Roman coins, while the reverse inventively celebrates Concordia, her proverbial marital concord with her husband Antoninus Pius. Boccaccio was fully aware of the commemorative function of Roman coins, which he believed, as many others until about the mid-16th century, not to have had value as currency, but being only commemorative pieces, and that they granted posthumous survival to the person depicted in them. This concept of posterity and survival through time is later echoed by Leon Battista Alberti in his treatise on painting, when he writes about the power of painting, and I quote from Leon Battista Alberti: "Painting contains a divine force which not only makes absent men present, and as friendship is said to do, but moreover makes the dead seem almost alive. Even after many centuries, they are recognized with great pleasure and with great admiration for the painter. Thus, the face of a man who is already dead certainly lives a long life through painting." And for many Renaissance writers, the medal, cast in the most noble materials, bronze or silver, had the further advantage of durability in comparison to painting. We should understand the Renaissance medal not only as the record of an individual likeness destined to posterity, but also as a tool to confirm and celebrate a specific social role and the virtues associated with it in front of a selected audience. The medal, therefore, lives in the present, and it is at the same time projected into the future, ensuring eternal fame to the sitter, but also establishing his or her place in contemporary society. Since the role of wife is one of the most frequently celebrated in Renaissance medals of women, often the occasion for the creation of a medal would have been the wedding itself. This is certainly the case of the medal attributed to Niccolò Fiorentino, depicting the young bride Giovanna degli Albizzi, who in 1486 married the wealthy Lorenzo Tornabuoni. And in the inscription, in fact, she's mentioned as Johanna Albizza Uxor, wife Laurenti de Tornabuonis. The father of Lorenzo, Giovanni Tornabuoni, was the manager and partner in the Roman branch of the Medici Bank, and his sister Lucrezia was the mother of Lorenzo de' Medici. As it was often the case, the Tornabuoni-Albizzi match had political objectives, and it was arranged by Lorenzo il Magnifico himself as a way of pulling the Albizzi further into the Medici orbit. The wedding took place in the summer of 1486, with great pomp and magnificence. The 3 days of celebrations were described in an epithalamium written by the poet Naldo Naldi. Throughout the poem, allusions to the beauty and charm of Giovanna are always paired with praise of her virtue and chastity. Beauty and chastity are also the virtues celebrated in the medal. No, I go back, sorry. In the portrait on the obverse, the necklace of pearls confirms that the sitter is a bride. For pearls, symbol of virginal purity, were traditional elements of wedding costumes and of a groom's gift. The jewel is probably the very same described in the will of Giovanna's father-in-law, Giovanni Tornabuoni, as uno pendente con uno rubino et uno diamante e tre perle, a pendant with one ruby, a diamond, and 3 pearls, which is also depicted in the famous posthumous portrait of Giovanna by Domenico Ghirlandaio, which is a great masterpiece preserved here in Madrid, actually, where the profile portrait of the young woman is based on our medal. So the portrait bears a date 1488, which is the date of her death, but probably was executed posthumously around 1490, based on the medal, on the portrait in the medal. The reverse of the medal, the reverse of the medal presents the 3 Graces who stand on a plinth side by side with arms interlocked. The motif of the 3 Graces derives from ancient representations such as the famous group today at the center of the Piccolomini Library in Siena, which was recorded in Rome in the possession of Cardinal Prospero Colonna at the end of the 15th century. But it is found also on ancient lamps, gems, and cameos. Here, the mythological trio embodies the exemplary female virtues of chastity, beauty, and love, as indicated by the inscriptions on the reverse. The figure of chastity holds springs of wet, symbols of fertility, while love holds a stem of myrtle, emblem of Venus. Beauty, pulcritudo, is represented as the mediator between chastity and love. Giovanna's portrait is provided also with an alternative reverse, which shows Venus in the guise of a huntress, accompanied by an inscription extracted from the first book of Virgil, of Virgil's Aeneid. Virginis os habitunque gerens et virginis arma, guised as a maiden in face and dress, with a girl's weapon. The suggestion here is that a chaste Venus, that we can identify with the bride, is ready to shoot her arrow toward her future husband. Giovanna's medal is complemented by a medal of the groom, Lorenzo, which bears a depiction of Mercury on the reverse. Although with no inscription, the god of graceful speech, trade and good fortune, but also the promoter of art, science and music, seems a perfect fit for the young Lorenzo, son of a merchant banker and a devout pupil of the great poet and humanist Angelo Poliziano, who might be behind the choice of the classicizing allegories of this remarkable group of medals. Taken as a group, the 3 medals well represent Lorenzo's cultural ambitions, Giovanna's beauty and virtue, and the couple's hope for a successful and prosperous marriage. Similar concepts presided to the lavish decoration of their newly furnished bedchamber in the Palazzo Tornabuoni, in particular the five spalliere or decorated wall panels which have come down to us. In two of the paintings, which were originally part of the decoration of the room, we see Apollo playing a viol above a pair of putti holding the Tornabuoni coat of arms, and Venus holding a bunch of roses with the Albizzi coat of arms underneath, clearly mirroring the newlywed couple. The rest of the decoration is centered on the deeds of Jason, Medea, and the Argonauts, where, in contrast with the tragic end of the story, Medea's love of and loyalty to Jason are emphasized, bringing the matrimonial bond to the fore. In the culminating scene of the cycle, painted by Biagio d'Antonio, Jason and Medea exchange ceremonial vows in the Temple of Apollo, employing an imagery which is very much alike that in other betrothal scenes, including that of the Virgin. Some scholars have also recognized Giovanna as the protagonist of one of the two frescoes by Sandro Botticelli today at the Louvre, which originally decorated one of the rooms in the Tornabuoni countryside villa at Chiasso Macerelli in the outskirts of Florence. Together with other scholars, I believe that the woman in Botticelli's fresco should be instead recognized as Ginevra Gianfigliazzi, Lorenzo Tornabuoni's second wife, married at the end of 1491. So Giovanna, first wife, gave birth to an heir in 1487, died in 1488, and then Lorenzo remarried in 1491 with Ginevra Gianfigliazzi, which is portrayed here in Botticelli's frescoes. And she is unmistakably, at least according to me, the same woman portrayed behind Giovanna in the mural painting with the Visitation by Domenico Ghirlandaio in the Tornabuoni Chapel in Santa Maria Novella, which was executed after the premature death of Giovanna in 1488 during her second pregnancy. Notwithstanding this identification, the subject of Botticelli's frescoes is another important indicator of the virtues and values associated with the married couple in 15th century Florence. In the portion reserved to Lorenzo, he is presented by the personification of grammar to philosophy and the other liberal arts. Ginevra's allegory, instead, is set in what seems to be a garden of love, characterized by a large fountain and a fertile landscape, or at least once fertile landscape, where flowers originally bloomed in the meadow. The young bride extends a handkerchief to catch flowers, probably roses, dropped into it by Venus, who is accompanied by the three graces. While in Lorenzo's mural the emphasis is on education and learning, which is consistent of what we know about his social intellectual ambitions, in the fresco with Ginevra the emphasis shifts to a female realm dominated by love and beauty. Marital and lineage concerns are certainly reflected in the celebration of love and fertility, but also contemporary ideals about beauty, which should be understood at the same time as outer beauty associated with Venus and inner beauty associated with the Graces. Virtutem forma decorat, beauty adorns virtue, is the motto painted on the back of the famous portrait of Ginevra Benci by Leonardo da Vinci. There cannot be a clearer statement of the concept that the outward appearance is the visible manifestation of a virtuous nature. The composition presents an emblematic portrait of the sitter, where the juniper at the center pans on the sitter's name, in Italian Ginevra, Ginepro, so juniper, Ginevra, while the laurel and the palm represent the virtues of chastity and faithfulness. Plant symbolism are often a feature of medals of women. In the portrait of Jacoba Correggia, the lily for purity, the laurel for chastity and the oak for faith are bound together on the left there, are bound together with a leather strap, and which is called Correggia in Italian. So again, a pun on the sitter's name, Jacoba Correggia, which ties her name with her virtues. In the inscription, she is called Forme Acmorum Domina, the mistress of beauty and manners. Similarly, Isotta degli Atti from Rimini,
we have two identical,
I'm sorry, there is no elephant, I'm sorry. Isotta degli Atti from Rimini is celebrated in her own medal as Forma et Virtute Italiae Decori, the ornament of Italy for beauty and virtue. Her medals represent a particularly striking case of political and dynastic legitimization achieved through a carefully orchestrated written and visual propaganda, in which medals play a significant role. Isotta was was the 13-year-old daughter of a well-to-do merchant from Rimini. When she was only 13 years old, she inspired the passion of Sigismondo Pandolfo Malatesta, the ruler of the city. The date 1446 on the obverse of her medal, which unfortunately, on the reverse, sorry, of the medal, which unfortunately we don't see, I don't know why here, is not a chronological indication for the execution of the peace, but instead commemorates the year Sigismondo consolidated his political power and won Isotta as his mistress. The medal must have been executed only after the death of Sigismondo's second wife, Polissena Sforza, in 1449, as part of a celebratory campaign for Isotta, which later led to her wedding with Sigismondo. Renaissance princes commonly had mistresses, but it was extremely rare, however, for a prince to actually marry his mistress. A letter of the humanist Timoteo Maffei to the author of the medal, the painter and illuminator Matteo De Pasti, mentions exemplars of the medal cast in gold, silver, and bronze by Matteo, and I quote from the letter in Latin, in de fossis locis disperse, vel muris intus locate, vel ad extras nationes transmisse, buried in scattered places, or placed within walls, or sent to foreign nations. There is concrete evidence that Sigismondo embedded portrait medals of himself and Isotta in the walls and foundations of his buildings as a legacy of his triumphant reign. This is a practice that was believed to have been employed by the Romans in the foundations of their buildings and that eloquently speaks of the commemorative function of the medal. While the reference in the letter to the fact that medals with Isotta's portrait were sent to extras naciones, to other people outside, testifies to the political propagandistic nature of these objects. The elephant, I'm really sorry that we cannot see it, portrayed on the medal's reverse, is a masterpiece of animal representation, at once naturalistic and richly symbolic. As one of the favorite heraldic devices of the Malatesta family of Rimini, the elephant signifies regal strength and the fame that confers immortality. Within the context of Isotta's medals, it has the clear function of signaling the dynastic legitimacy of the woman, whose son Sallustio was destined to become Sigismondo's heir and successor. The floral tops on the obverse, in the form of heraldic four petals Malatesta roses, which are echoed in the jewel on Isotta's forehead, are another subtle but clear indication of the dynastic nature of the portrait. The emblem of the elephant is ubiquitous in the sculptural decoration of the Tempio Malatestiano, the medieval church of San Francesco in the heart of Rimini, that the Florentine architect Leon Battista Alberti and the sculptor Agostino Di Duccio transformed in a temple to the glory of Sigismondo and his family, including a funerary chapel with a lavish tomb for Isotta that was erected before her death. The archenemy of Sigismondo, Pope Pius II Piccolomini, wrote in his commentaries that the Lord of Rimini, and I quote, erected a magnificent marble tomb for his mistress. While, as a cultivated humanist and art lover, he admired the exquisite craftsmanship, artificio et lapide pulcherrimum, he also noticed that the inscription ran in pagan style, sacred to the deified Isotta. I quote the Latin, is interesting. Concubine sue tumulum erexit, et artificio et lapide pulcherrimum, adiecto titulo gentili more inunc modum, dive Isotte sacrum. We should notice that the current inscription, where Isotta is celebrated as diva, as we have seen in many contemporary medals of women, worth of celebration, BM, bene merenti, replaced the previous inscription, which is underneath, eccola qui, replace the previous inscription, which was identical to the inscription on the medal by Matteo dei Pasti, Forma et Virtute Italiae Decori. Many medals of the 15th and 16th centuries often defined their female subjects in relation to a male relative, usually the father or the husband of the sitter, as we have seen in the portrait of Battista Sforza by Piero della Francesca and in the medal of Giovanna Tornabuoni. In the medal by Fra Antonio da Brescia, Dea Contarini, for example, is exclusively defined as the wife, uxor of Niccolò Michiel, no? Dea Contarine uxoreius. Doctor, knight, and procurator of St. Mark's titles are all described in the around his portrait. Or the Veronese Beatrice della Torre, for example, is characterized in the inscription as the daughter of Giulio della Torre, probably figlia dilecta Giulio della Torre, and the wife of Zeno Pucchi. And the allegory of fecundity on the reverse is clearly related to their wedding, which must be the reason for the creation of the medal itself. The Empress Isabella of Portugal appears on a medal by Leone Leoni as the wife of Charles V, and the medal of Ippolita Gonzaga, also by Leoni, describes her as the daughter of Ferrante Gonzaga. The legends on these medals reflect the gender-based nature of power in the period, but also more immediately highlight the general different roles played by men and women in the production of medals. For although it is the beauty and virtue of the woman that are being commemorated in these works, it was usually their male partner or father who commissioned and paid for the medals. And the legends both serve as a reminder that the women's glory depended on the men. In this respect, it is interesting to consider portrait medals of female rulers or women with considerable political or government responsibilities. One of the most accomplished medals of the 16th century, the portrait of Maria Tudor, Queen of England from 1553 to 1558 by the Italian medalist Jacopo d'Atrezzo, was probably commissioned by her future husband, Philip II, King of Spain, as a tribute to Mary before their wedding. The portrait was possibly modeled in London by Jacopo, who was at the time at the service of Philip II, still in Brussels. Mary appears in the medal as she does in the famous portrait of Antonio Moro, which was commissioned in 1554 by Charles V and executed in London by the Flemish artist, so probably during a real sitting. In both the painting and the medal, which I'm showing here in a very beautiful example cast in gold, she wears a pendant jewel that is probably to be identified with one sent to her in June 1554 by Philip and described as a great diamond with a large pendant, one of the most beautiful pieces ever seen in the world. The inscription emphasizes her role as a defender of faith, fidei defensatrix. The elaborate verse symbolizes the peaceful state of the kingdom under Mary, and it is dominated by the figure of a crowned piece setting fire to arms. The cube, the clasped hands, and the scales, they are visible, they are underneath, are symbols of stability, unity, and justice, respectively. The figures beset by storms on the left are Mary's subjects before her accession to the throne, while under her reign they bask in radiant sunlight on the right. Beautiful, like domed temple. The inscription reads as sight to the blind, tranquility to the fearful, cecis visus timidis quies. Another medal of a female ruler, for which we have interesting information on its commission, is that of Margaret of Parma, executed by the Flemish goldsmith and sculptor Jacob Jongeling in 1567, when she was 45 years old. Margaret, as well known, was the illegitimate daughter of Emperor Charles V. When in 1559 her stepbrother, Philip II, left the Low Countries to go back to Spain, he asked her to become the governor general of the turbulent province, agitated by endless conflicts between Catholics and Protestants. Thanks to a letter of Captain Francesco de Marchi, a military engineer and trusted advisor attached to the person of the Duchess, sent from Antwerp in 1567 to Cardinal Alessandro Farnese, we are unusually well informed about the execution and purpose of the medal. It appears that the medal was commissioned directly by the Marchi, that he persuaded the Duchess to be portrayed al naturale from life, from Jongeling. Although the portrait appears remarkably close to her portrait by Antonis Moore, and that the Marquis himself was the inventor of the allegory on the reverse, where Margaret was depicted as defensora della religione cristiana, defender of Christian religion. And he says in the letter, very interesting, lo inventore del roverse sono stato io, che l'ho fatto fare senza che Sua Altezza lo sapesse. I was the inventor of the reverse that was made without Her Royal Highness knowing. The first two examples of the medal in silver were sent along with the letter, one destined to the Cardinal Alessandro Farnese and the other to the Pope, the Dominican Pius V, for them to see the portrait of a woman of the Farnese house, because as we know, Margaret was the wife of the Cardinal's brother, Ottavio, Duke of Parma and Piacenza, dressed in arms to defend the interest of the Church in the name of the Pope. The reverse, devised by the Marchi, shows, in fact, a female figure standing on a rock, battered by wind and waves, wearing a laurel wreath, with a sword in the right hand, palm and olive branches in the left. Clearly, the figure, a sort of a peace in arms, is meant to be Margaret herself, and the motto, favente Deo, if God so wishes, alludes to her efforts to control insurrection and instability. I would like to conclude examining an especially compelling example, which we will hear more, I think, later, of a woman who was fully involved in commissioning her own medal, Isabella d'Este, the famous Marquess of Mantua, Marchioness of Mantua. As it is well known, she was an avid collector of both classical antiquities and works of art by the leading contemporary painters and sculptors of the day. As with her other artistic commissions, Isabella was deeply involved in an intense dialogue with the maker, in this case the sculptor and cartier Gian Cristoforo Romano, who also often acted as her agent in acquiring objects, probably including the many ancient coins she possessed. The object that you see here on screen is the item cast in gold and surrounded by a rich mounting with rubies, diamonds, and enamels that she kept for herself, while other versions of the medal in bronze and lead were sent out to other rulers, friends and admirers all over Italy. Quite unusually for a medal, we have an interesting document about the contemporary reception of the piece. In October 1507, the Mantuan envoy in Naples, Giacomo d'Atri, wrote to Isabella, recording the presence of Gian Cristoforo Romano at the court of Naples. The sculptor had given an example of the medal of the Marchioness to him, which he called a thousand times beautiful, and also showed the medal to several members of the Neapolitan court. Among others, the queen consort of Aragon, Germaine de Foix, could not stop admiring the medal and remarking that, beyond the singular beauty, the portrait showed a great intelligence, of which she heard many times when she was in France. Interesting, obviously, the Italian text. She's looking at the medal, che parea non se potesse saciar de guardare, dicendo che ultra la singolare bellezza, che l'effigia indicava un grande insegno, come per fama al tempo che essa era in Francia molte volte aveva udito. How could Germaine de Foix have divined Isabella's insegno just looking at her effigy? This may have something to do not just with the portrait, but with the figuration on the reverse. The reverse depicts a winged figure in classical dress, holding a palm branch in her left hand and a short staff or wand in her right, while a serpent rises up in front of her. The figure depicted on top is a Sagittarius, Isabella's astrological ascendant sign. The allegory is surrounded by the inscription Benemerentium Ergo, which could be translated as on account of merit. Although the figuration on the reverse is clearly inspired by classical precedents, as also the size of the medal, which is quite small, very close to an antique coin, there is no precise individual source for the figuration on the reverse. The figure is instead a particularly sophisticated reworking of images found on coins of Roman emperors. We know that Isabella discussed at length the inscription with the court humanist Niccolò da Correggio because she wanted something entirely new. Following Isabella's guidelines, Niccolò suggested three possible inscriptions for the reverse, the one which is in the medal, Benemerentium Ergo, because of merit, but also other two, Nature Officium, the duty of nature, and Gratitudinis Studio, with the duty of gratitude. The Marchioness chose Benemerentium Ergo, which stresses the recipient's merit rather than the patron's gratitude or duty. The overall meaning of the reverse, still discussed, seems to be a celebration of Isabella's abilities as a peacekeeping ruler through her star-given ability to govern in the absence of her husband Francesco, often engaged in warfare. The Medal of Isabella is, in many respects, at least for this period, exceptional in the panorama that we have delineated here. It was directly commissioned by her. The iconography, an allegory of good government, which presents the woman on the same level as the male ruler, was devised by her in close dialogue with her court sculptor and with a court humanist for the inscription. If in the beautiful all'antica portrait the medal is certainly a celebration of Isabella's beauty, it is in the learned complexity of the reverse, which demands decoding rather than instant comprehension, that the medal brilliantly demonstrates her insegno, her intelligence and originality. Thank you.
En una de las fotografías sale un mausoleo y salen varios símbolos que parece que es una S y una raya vertical. Parece que es el símbolo del dólar o algo así. Es el
mausoleo que se ven los elefantes debajo.
Ah.
Sí, pues En italiano.
Sono e Sigismondo. They are the no. the emblem of the husband. Let's go back.
No, 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 más para atrás, más para atrás. Ahí, ahí.
Sigismondo. Sigismondo.
Sigismondo.
The name of the husband.
La inicial, es la inicial del hombre.
Sí, sí, es que como que se ve mucho.
Which could be interpreted of Sigismondo and Isotta.
Ay, thank you, gracias. Prego.
Bueno, me ha parecido interesantísimo.